Hello, I'm John Rose, Director of Chirp Maritime. Welcome to the third of our bulletins, available online and in podcast. We'll be bringing you three case studies today, events where avoidable hazards put seafarers in danger. To take you through our findings on how such hazards can and should be avoided, we'll be joined later by my Chirp colleague, Lieutenant Commander David Carter. We seem to be hitting the mark with our viewers and listeners, and we're grateful for your support. Keep sending us reports. Stand by for contact details at the end of our bulletin. One sector that we haven't heard too much from yet is the superyacht industry, and we'd like to. It'd also be good to hear from tug crews and the fishing industry. In fact, we think there's room for improvement in all shipping sectors, in openness of discussion and in the design of the vessels themselves, from bridge layout to mooring equipment. Don't put up with problems. Tell us. We'll get your concerns to those who can really make a difference, from naval architects to classification societies and flag state authorities. That's for the future, the near future, I hope. Back now to the present, let's look at some of our latest reports.
Report 1. Power loss, poor communication and design in a ship manoeuvring on approach to a lock. Under the guidance of a pilot, a large pure car carrier, a PCC, was being manoeuvred into a lock with the assistance of a tug at her stern. There was limited visibility alongside the ship as she came into the lock. This problem was compounded by difficulties in communication across the very wide bridge space, with key instruments at the con in three different positions. On entering the lock, the ship needed to slow, but deceleration was only happening very gradually. Unknown to the pilot, the ship's main engine had failed to start twice. This only became clear when the master, apparently rather distraught, inquired whether the stern tug was pulling. Acting on the developing emergency, the pilot immediately laid the ship along the rubber coping fenders on the dockside to bring her to a stop. It was then that the main engine restarted astern and the car carrier was safely stopped and moored.
In an environmentally conscious age, newer electronic engines have reduced fuel injection on engine startup, with a 10-second pause before restart. In confined spaces such as a lock, standard practice is to have thrusters ready for use, in addition to tugboat assistance. The company says this condition was fulfilled. But the emergency that developed in this case underlines the importance of clear briefings and pre-arrival checks between pilot and master, with testing of conning procedure and the use of bridge wing controls well in advance. This the more so because of wide spaces across the very large bridge to be covered by master and pilot during such a close manoeuvre. Chirp also recommends that experienced deck officers should always be involved in the design of bridge layout, with special attention paid to visibility from bridge wings and to machinery controls.
Report 2. Safely moored? In our next case, clearly not. A passenger ship was getting underway in a berth hard by this vessel. As the passenger ship cleared her berth, the two ships were uncomfortably close at 20 meters separation, so crew members were standing by to tend mooring lines if needed. As can be seen, these seafarers were in extremely dangerous positions if any of the lines were to part and snap back. A badly chosen berth has meant that their ship has been unable to run stern lines, and both back spring and breast lines have poor leads. Furthermore, mooring lines have been fitted at a sharp angle, increasing the risk of overstraining caused by interaction between the two ships. Overall, the after mooring station does not seem to be well designed, and crew members in the picture, officers and men, seem unaware of the danger of snapback, a peril heightened by the prospect of surge load as the nearby passenger ship clears the dock.
This large vessel is quite simply in the wrong berth. Mooring arrangements are intended for long leads, fore and aft, and charterers should always be mindful of this when arranging a berth. And masters always ready to refuse it if it is not safe. As can be seen, these stern mooring lines are in a reverse direction because of the layout and size of this inappropriate berth, putting them under increased strain and very probably increasing the likelihood of failure if close manoeuvring occurs, as in this case. The consequences of all this could have been lethal, even fatal. The whole aft mooring deck is, in effect, a snapback zone, confined and with multiple unconventional leads. Chirp recommends that unauthorised movement on working decks should be expressly forbidden, and that identifying and clearly marking tension spots should be actively considered, marking out relative safe spaces for mooring parties to place themselves. Training and clear orders for mooring discipline should also be the norm for all seafarers. In general, the key problem with snapback zones is this. They create a false sense of security, leading to a risk of injury if a mooring line parts and recoils across the deck. The UK Maritime Coast Guard Agency has recommended that painted snapback areas should be removed, and warning signs posted to identify the whole of the mooring area as a potential snapback zone. A supervisor dedicated to safe operating procedures should be in control. Heightened risk demands strengthened oversight. More on this subject can be found in Maritime Feedback number 39, available on our website.
Report 3. A fouled anchor on a superyacht led to an extremely hazardous operation by a single crew member to clear the obstruction, with the vessel already underway. The crew member can be seen on the starboard quarter of the superyacht. He stood on a ledge just above the waterline, the yacht was proceeding slowly, and then jumped into the water and swam up to the bow. He had no life jacket or safety line. At the bow, the crewman stood on the anchor to clear it, while his shipmates continued to raise it. With the job done, he went back into the sea and allowed himself to drift down the superyacht's starboard side. He was then recovered on board.
It goes without saying that this was an extremely hazardous and ill-judged operation. The seafarer could have become entangled in the foul line, trapped underwater, or even dragged astern towards the superyacht's propellers. It is not clear that anyone was supervising this man's risk-taking. It is highly unlikely he could have been observed from the bridge. The company in question reacted positively to our report and gave us an outline of how they aim to improve health and safety awareness, with such risk not to be taken from now on, and a full drill put in place for clearing fouled anchors. This to include a rescue boat, two crew members observing at the bow, and VHF links between bridge, bow and boat. Overall though, the lessons to be learned from this hair-raising incident are very clear. There needs to be risk assessment of unusual actions like this, based on a safety culture driven from the top. Key actions must be taken to maintain safety, along with standard provision of life jackets and lifelines and safety boats. The whole to be closely supervised throughout. And of course, this doesn't just apply to superyachts. These cardinal rules apply in all circumstances to all vessels.
Well, that completes our third Chirp Online Bulletin. Don't forget, we're always ready to hear from you, and as always, everything you tell us will be treated in complete confidence, with every precaution taken to make sure that there's absolutely no chance that anything you tell us can be traced back to you, or your ship, or your company. We need your help to make safer seas for all seafarers. Please email us at reports@chirp.co.uk. That email address again, reports@chirp.co.uk. Thanks for being with us. We look forward to hearing from you.